believe in history is the best teacher, and we should learn from history. They say if you don't learn, you condemn, you make the same mistakes all over again.
My Lord, I wouldn't be so arrogant as to say that I have never made any mistakes or that those mistakes have not been historical. But that's not an issue before this Honorable Court, so let's not go there. My Lord, may I briefly, because a number of things are being said at various junctures, submit to your Lordship that you may kindly consider to look at the case as set up by the appellant before this Honorable Court, because even this morning it opened up with something which was startling and beyond the pleadings. So while I accept that this court under Article 185, read with one Article 87, does not act beyond limits of jurisdiction, but it has got more leeway than many other courts. But let's look at the pleadings. My Lord, CA 333, paragraph 3. Paragraph 4, page 6 of the appeal. Paragraph 4, page 6, Civil Appeal 333 of 2024. That the petitioner, page 6, paragraph 4, Civil Appeal 333, that the petitioner number 1 did not contest the general election of 2024 on its election symbol, and its electoral candidates contested the said general election as independent candidates. The petitioner number 1, my Lord, is the Sunni Ittehad Council. It is precisely because of the reason that the petitioner number 1 did not contest the election under its election symbol, that it did not submit any party list for reserve seats under Section 104 Election Act 2017. This is their case, my Lord. My Lord, if your Lordship may graciously turn the page, they refer to the seats. And if your Lordship may then take a look at page 10, ground A, Lord, this is about 9 lines from the top. The central constitutional basis of the right to reserve seats under the proportional representation system is total number of general seats secured by each political party from the province concerned in the National Assembly, or total number of general seats secured by each political party in the Provincial Assembly. In other words, the fact whether the political party which now has general seats in the assembly had fought the election or not is not a constitutional requirement for the election of reserved seats under proportional representation system. If your Lordship may see the last line. Secondly, there is nothing in Article 51(6). Paragraphs D and E of the Constitution, which requires that the political party which has general seats in the National Assembly due to independent returns candidate joining it should have necessarily contested the elections and also won some seat. If your Lordship may skip 3 lines. Thirdly, the other requirement, that is selected in accordance with law as well as the submission of list of candidates as mentioned in the aforementioned Article 51 and Article 106, have to be read in harmony with the aforementioned 2 principles and cannot override the aforementioned principles. Fourthly, there is nothing in the aforementioned Article 51 as well as Article 106 which requires the list of candidates for reserve seats to be submitted before any general election. Ground B, my Lord, if your Lordship may see the 4th line from the foot of the page. In other words, the requirement to submit lists for reserve seats prior to the general election only applies to political parties who contest such election and not to political parties who become parliamentary parties, political parties in the National Assembly as well as Provincial Assembly as a result of the joining of independent returned candidates. Such political parties can only rationally and practically submit their candidate list for reserve seats after the joining of such returned independent returned candidates post the general election. Second, Section 104, Election Act 2017 and Rule 92 and 94 of the election rules could not apply logically as well as practically to parliamentary political parties who acquire general seats in the National Assembly as well as a result as provincial assemblies as a result of the independent return candidates joining the petitioner number one in the post-general election period. It is obvious that aforementioned Section 104 and Rules 92 and 94 are legally silent and do not apply to such cases as the petition number one, in which the acquiring of the general seats of the Assembly takes place after the election, general election, through independent returned candidates joining them. Thirdly, it is apparent from Article 51 as well as Article 106 that specifies no time period as to when the list of candidates is to be submitted, whether prior or to or post the general election, and therefore the aforementioned sections 104 and Rule 92 and Rule 94 cannot override the constitutional provisions of Article 51 and Article 106. Therefore, the impugned judgment is erroneous and liable to be set aside. If your lordship may graciously turn the page, ground D, ninth line from the foot of the page. In other words, the fact whether the political party which now has general seats in the National Assembly had fought the election or not is not a constitutional requirement for the allocation of reserved seats under proportional representation. If your lordship may graciously turn the page, page 14, ground E. This, my lord, last seven lines. There is nothing in Article 51(6)(d) of the Constitution which requires that the political party which has general seats in the National Assembly due to independent return candidates joining it should have necessarily contested the election and also won some seats. Contrary to this, the proviso to Article 51(6)(d) of the Constitution legally converts the independent return candidates as seats won by even a party which may not have contested the general election. My lord, if your lordship may turn to page 16 graciously. Last five lines on the first paragraph on this page, and that's the last part I would be reading. Secondly, it is obvious and apparent from Articles 51 as well as Article 106 of the Constitution that it specifies no time period as to when the list of candidates is to be submitted, that is whether prior to or post the general election. Therefore, para 3 of the impugned judgment is erroneous. My lord, this is the case which they have set up. It is not their case as set up in the pleadings that they, due to any extraneous pressure, were not able to contest the elections as SIC. They say they did not. They did not submit a list of reserved seats. What is my case? My case is that when your lordship looks at Article 51 of the Constitution, the main provision. It requires that members to the reserved seats, I skip the words women, my lord, because it will be minorities under 106, shall be elected in accordance with law. That's the first requirement. Elected.
What does elected mean here? I mean, elsewhere, when this word elected or cognate expressions are used, they are used in the sense of an electorate, polling day, election, if contested, yes, counting of votes, result announced, etc. We all know that, right? And here, the election in accordance with law, which is the Elections Act, is there's no election at all in the you might say the settled or normal sense of the word. Now I'm not denying or challenging what is being done, but it seems to me that if what is being done is constitutional, which everyone appears to think it is in terms of how the proportionality is worked and so on, then the word elected as used over here is used in a somewhat different meaning from how it is used elsewhere in the Constitution. Well, what do you say to that?
My lord, may I, with your lordship's leave, submit my understanding of it?
Ji.
Over here,
जस्ट टू एम्फसाइज द पॉइंट, अगर आप आर्टिकल 226 देखें, काइंडली आर्टिकल 226 निकालें. इसको काइंडली पढ़िए.
All elections under the Constitution, other than those of the Prime Minister and the Chief Minister, shall be by secret ballot.
So, if election as used in paragraph B has the same sense as used elsewhere, what is happening under this law is totally unconstitutional, prima facie. But I'm saying, and I'm repeating, I don't say that, and everyone else seems to agree that that is not so. So, therefore, the interpretation, the proper interpretation of the word elected over here is perhaps different from how this word or cognate expressions are used elsewhere in the Constitution.
My Lord.
And therefore, does that not also lead to a possible interpretation that the word political party, as used in paragraph D, may be used, and certainly in the context of unusual situations or circumstances, of which perhaps what we are facing today is one, in a sense that may not be the same sense as it is used elsewhere? What would you say to that?
My submission is that the way I understand election as used in clause D is that the election in accordance with law, and the way then the Election Act goes about it, is that the party is, when the country is called to the general elections, also required to submit a list of reserved seats. It is also required to then assign a priority to it, which priority cannot be changed till the list is
exhausted.
The simple
answer to that could be, well, what about Article 226, secret ballot? I mean, in a vanilla election, no dispute, no nothing, party A gets 10, party B gets 5, party C gets 3. Someone could file a petition and say, all unconstitutional. Why? Read Article 226. Every election has to be by secret ballot. Where's the ballot? There's not even a ballot. Forget secret. Someone could say that. My response, speaking for myself, would be, sorry, sir, you are wrong, because the word elected over here is perhaps used in a different sense. And I'm linking that, the reason I'm saying it is because I'm linking that to the use of the word political party over here. And therefore, if we know the general rule, right? Word or expression used different places, prima facie, the assumption is same meaning. Here, quite obviously not the same meaning. Well, if one word not the same meaning, why not another word?
The submission respectfully is, on my understanding of the provision, that election over here means that the list which is set by the parties, as I said, where the candidates are there, who file their nomination papers, whose nomination papers are scrutinized, and a priority is determined. This list, in terms of law, goes to general election. When general elections are contested, a person voting for party A knows that there is a list of notified candidates on the reserved list, and a consequence of my vote will be that some of these, not all of these, in terms of priority, may get elected. So the electorate has a say in it. If they vote for a political party and that political party wins 10 seats, the consequence may be that they may get
but
other
then,
seats.
Coming to what my learned colleague Sayyid Mansoor Ali Shah asked, then therefore, for this election, it is that will of the people, the representativeness, that is of crucial importance, that must be protected, preserved, and defended, both by the Election Commission and by us.
Yes.
Because you see, we take the oath of office that we will protect the Constitution, preserve, defend, and I won't say blah, blah, blah. God forbid. But you get the point. But where does this Constitution come from? The Constitution tells us where it comes from. Where does it come from?
The preamble. It comes from the people. Sovereignty belongs
to the people. We the people.
Yes.
So when we are talking of the Constitution, when we take an oath of office to preserve, protect and defend the constitution, what we are saying is we will preserve, protect and defend the will of the people, because this thing, which yes, a certain gentleman said, ye kya cheez hai, kagaz ka tukda hai, main phad ke phenk dun, wrong, with all due respect to the gentleman, but our oath of office leads back to the people. Aapki apni formulation pe election as used and understood in paragraph leads back to the people, and that if you is correct, then the representativeness, as my learned colleagues have been emphasizing during the morning session, that is of critical, crucial importance.
Mason, yes, nobody will say that the people are to be excluded from the process. My submission is that this list very much goes to the people. The people vote
directly.
Vote indirectly, yes. But the list, as your lordship knows, is notified. The priority is determined. So when a person casts a vote in the general election, that person knows that the direct consequence may be that X may get elected on the general seat. And the indirect consequence may be that if others acting like him in other constituencies act in the same manner, then there will people on the reserve list may get elected.
Now, यहाँ पे सवाल ये पैदा होता है कि क्या ये जो reserve seat की list दी जाती है, ये will of the people के मुताबिक होती है या people अपना इख्तियार party के candidates को देते हैं कि आपका जो जी चाहे वो कर ले, number one.